Let's close our eyes for prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you at this time. We bless your name and we worship you, that you have picked us out of the multitudes of believers in our nation, and you have made us the leaders that we are. Lord, we pray that you will fill us with yourself, and that you will fill us with your sweetness, and fill us with your fullness, and stamp your image upon our hearts in Jesus' name. Lord, we come to an important session, becoming a leader that sees, that knows, that becomes a seer. We pray, oh Lord, we'll see everything we ought to see, everyone we ought to see, and we'll reproduce the image of Christ in everyone in Jesus' name. Bless your people, Lord. Lift your people higher. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen. God bless every one of you. Keep me true, Lord Jesus, keep me true. Keep me true, Lord Jesus, keep me true. There is a race I must run. There is a victory to be won. Give me power every hour to be true. Keep me brave, keep me brave, Lord Jesus, keep me brave. Keep me brave, Lord Jesus, keep me brave. There's a race I must run. There is a victory to be won. Give me power every hour to be brave. Keep me tough. Keep me tough. Keep me tough, Lord Jesus, keep me tough. There's a race I must run. There is a victory to be won. Give me power every hour to be tough. Keep me sound. Keep me sound, keep me sound, Lord Jesus, keep me sound. There's a race I must run. There is a victory to be won. Give me power every hour to be sound. Keep me true, keep me true, Lord Jesus, keep me true, keep me true. There is a race I must run. There is a victory to be won. Give me power every hour to be true. Let's open our Bibles to 1 Samuel chapter 9. 1 Samuel chapter 9. We're still continuing our series of the biblical pictures of leadership. And this time now we're looking at the leader as a seer. In 1 Samuel chapter 9, I'm reading from verse 9. 1 Samuel chapter 9, reading from verse 9. It says in verse 9, before time, in Israel, when a man went to inquire of God, thus he spake, come, and let us go to the seer. For he that is now called a prophet was before time called a seer. The prophet was a great leader in the land of Israel, and all the prophets were counted as leaders. They led the people. They led the authorities, the officers. They even led the kings. And those seers, those prophets, were leaders that could actually lead the nation aright. And they could lead all the people aright through the king. And so, they knew that they could see the vision of the Lord. They could see the direction in which the nation ought to go. They could see what had gone wrong in the nation too. And they could see enough as to bring them back to the way, because they also saw the way. And therefore they refer to those prophets, those leaders, as seers. In verse 10, then said Saul to his servant, well said, come, let us go. So they went unto the city where the man of God was. And as they went up the hill to the city, they found young maidens going out to draw water, and said unto them, is the seer here? They were searching for the seer. And what did they expect the seer to tell them? They were looking for asses. And they wanted the seer to be able to tell them where the asses could be found. I want you to notice something now. A leader is a seer. And the people believe that he is a seer. And the people believe that he will show them what they were looking for. What were they looking for? They were looking for asses. What was the nation looking for? The nation was looking for a king. And so I want to show you something to start with. The people will want you to see things that are not too essential. Things that whether we find them or we don't find them, it doesn't really make too much of a difference. And three asses being lost and a seer finding those asses is not a big deal. You want to find a king for the nation. You want to find a leader for your region. You want to find a leader for every section of the world. And as we talk about the seer, we may even stand in the position of the seer, and we may be operating in the ministry of the seer, and yet the things we see and the people will see and the proper and the animals will see, it may not really matter much whether we saw them or not. So don't allow people to lower your ministry to the point that they just make you to see the things that are of temporal value, and the things that even if they discovered, it wouldn't make too much of a difference to the family, or too much of a difference to the community, or too much of a difference to the province, or too much of a difference to the region, or too much of a difference to the state, or too much of a difference to the nation. And so here we find they came in verse 11, as they went up the hill of the city to the city, they found young maidens going out to draw water, and said unto them, is a seer here? And they answered and said, he is, behold, is before you. Make haste now, for he came today to the city. I want to tell you another thing. Even though you are a seer, as a leader, there should be a connection between the seer and the seen. That is, and the one that is seen. If there is no connection between the leader and the followers, no connection between the leader and the people that you have seen, and the people you want to bring into the ministry, into the work, into royalty, then will not be able to do too much. For there is a sacrifice of the people today in the high place. As soon as ye become into the city, ye shall straightway find him before he go up to the high place to eat, and for the people will not eat until he come. Do you see that? The people, they will not eat until he come. The position they gave that prophet, the position of the privilege they gave that seer, and the royalty and the honor and the respect they gave to that leader, because they will not even eat until he comes, because he does bless the sacrifice, and nobody else will do that, because it was the prerogative and the privilege of that leader, of that seer, to do that. And afterwards they eat that be bidden. Now therefore get you up, for about this time ye shall find him. And they went up into the city, and when they were come into the city, behold, Samuel came out against them for to go up to the high place. Now the Lord had told Samuel in his ear a day before Saul came, saying, tomorrow about this time I will send a man out of the land of Benjamin. I will send a man out of the land of Benjamin. We need to understand how God works, because you know, you can read all these passages and you may not discover how God is working. God said, I'm going to send a man unto you. And did God talk to Saul directly? No, not at all. Was he God that sent Saul to Samuel? Yes, of a truth. How did God send Saul to Samuel? He led the servant of Saul to tell him, why don't we look for a seer? And you may not know that that is a word of inspiration. That is coming from God. But that simple advice was actually coming from God. And then you said the right thing. What made Saul to be able to say, yes, you said the right thing. I'm going to allow my servant to direct me and to lead me at this time. I'm going to listen to him. That was of the Lord. Because it was part of the process that God was following to send Saul unto the seer, unto Samuel. And then they got these three ladies. And these ladies, and as they were going, these, they found, I don't know whether they're three young maidens, these ladies. Is a seer here? What made those ladies to be nice at this time? And then to wait and say, yes, the seer actually is coming. How is it that these ladies, these maidens, they had the information? And in a very polite way, in an inviting manner, in a good manner, they answered and they responded. That is part of the process. What am I telling you? Everything that happens to us, even when they don't appear to be spiritual, when they don't appear to be religious, when it is just the normal day-to-day thing, God is working out everything and is leading you step by step. And then eventually, even the way they took, wouldn't there have been many roads? Maybe there were many roads. And at the crossroad there, they took this road and they just got to the place. It was the same road that Samuel himself was taking. How about that? That was the leading of God. We need to understand then that the little things that happen to us, will not despise them. Will not say, maybe that's just accidental. I don't want to, you know, get involved in that. I don't want my younger people, upcoming leaders, to tell me anything. Hold it yourself. I know what I'm going to do. Don't do that. And let everything that happens be a way of God leading you to the seer. And then eventually we're told in verse 16, tomorrow by this time, that's what God told him, I will send thee a man out of the land of Benjamin, and thou shalt anoint him the captain over my people Israel, that he may save my people out of the hand of the Philistines. For I have looked upon my people, because their cry is come unto me. I cannot go away from that verse without telling you leaders something. Here, the Lord even planned what the ministry of Saul was going to be. A captain over my people. And this is the major reason I'm choosing him. The major reason is that he will save my people out of the hand of the Philistines. He will save my people out of the hands of the Philistines. He will save my people out of the hands of the Philistines. I'm wondering now, did Saul eventually get to doing that? I don't think so. I think it was David that actually saved the people from the hand of the Philistines. And I think that Saul just branched off and he wanted to destroy David and all his intelligence, all his wisdom, all his army. Everything he directed at David. He wanted to fight just one man instead of fighting the Philistines. Be very careful. The Lord has called you for a purpose, and he called you for a ministry. Concentrate on that ministry. All along the way, there may be some things that challenge you. There may be some things that even annoy you. There may be some things that will try to distract you. And then you just go on the trip, another trip. Now, all you want to do is to be able to get rid of a man, of a little David. Get away from David and remember what the Lord has chosen you to do. And in verse 17, and when Samuel saw Saul, the Lord said unto him, behold, the man whom I spake to thee of, this same shall reign over my people. Then Saul drew near to Samuel in the gate and said, tell me, I pray thee, where the seer's house is. And Samuel answered Saul and said, I am the seer. Go up before me unto the high place, for ye shall eat with me today, and tomorrow I will let thee go, and I will tell thee all that is in thine heart. And as for thine asses, relax. You know, when you are talking to people and they have some burden in their hearts, and they have some things that are number one in their hearts, and every other thing you say will not get into them, you'll not communicate with them because there's something that is uppermost in their heart, solve that problem. Be a problem solver so you can be a good communicator. Your communication is going to be effective when you have solved the problems that is actually bugging the people, bothering the people. Therefore, he said, as for thine asses that were lost 3 days ago, set not thine mind on them, for they are found. And on whom is all the desire of Israel? Is it not on thee and on all thy father's house? The point is this, that the leader is a seer. And as leaders, we must understand that where Christ indwelt and we're spirit-filled, and because of that we have a prophetic perception, and we see what others do not see. We see what others do not see. In John chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 45. John chapter 1, reading from verse 45. Philip findeth Nathanael, and said unto him, where found him, of whom Moses in the law and the prophets did write, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. And Nathanael said unto him, can any good thing come out of Nazareth? Philip saith unto him, come and see. Jesus saw Nathanael coming to him, and says of him, behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom is no guile. And Philip must have been surprised. I didn't see that in Nathanael. What I saw in Nathanael is a doubter. Because when I said, we have seen him, of whom the word of God, Moses did write in the law, in the prophets, and the prophets also wrote, that the Messiah will come, is Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. I remember what Nathanael told me. Nathanael said, can any good thing come out of Nazareth? And then I said, come and see what Jesus is saying. Behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom is no guile. Jesus saw something that Philip did not see. And if the Lord will give you the eyes of a leader, then you will see what others are not able to see. Seer leaders, that is the leaders who are seers, or visionary leaders, they see possibilities in seemingly impossible situations. That's why we're seers. Not only that, seers leaders, that is the leaders who are seers, they see champions in cowards. They see champions in cowards waiting to be released. They just know that although he appears to be a coward now, there is a champion within him waiting to be released. Not only that, leaders who are seers see the future pretty well paused in the present persecuting souls. There is a soul that is persecuting the church, and yet Jesus can see a future profitable Paul, a future apostolic Paul, a future dynamic Paul for the kingdom of God. Don't just look at the temporal. Don't look at the external. Don't look at the present. Look beyond that as a leader. That's why we're leaders. Leaders see uncompromising, fearless Peters in fearful, undependable Simons. When they come to you, they look like Simon, and they look undependable, and they look fearful. But if you have the eyes of a leader, and you can see, you will see the uncompromising, fearless, and bold, aggressive Peter that will be able to say, if you consider it, whether we'll obey you or obey God, but we will rather obey God. The leaders then will see. They will see profitable treasure in weak, hardened vessels. True leaders are seers. They see beyond the present, and they see beyond the obvious. My question to you is, what seest thou? What do you see? In the people in the ministry, in the women in the ministry, in the children in the ministry, in the youths in the ministry, what seest thou? What do you see in yourself? What do you see in others? What do you see in your colleagues? What do you see in the ministry? Leaders are seers. I divide the message to three parts. Number one, the compelling vision of a seer leader. The compelling vision of a leader who is a seer. Number two, the comprehensive vocation of a seer leader. A leader who is a seer. The comprehensive vocation. Number three, the character building virtue of a seer leader. The character building virtue of a seer leader. I come to number one, the compelling vision of a seer leader. When you are a leader, be a seer as well, and then have the vision. We're told in Isaiah chapter 53, that the Lord Jesus Christ actually saw beyond the cross, and he saw beyond the pain, and he saw beyond the crucifixion, and he saw beyond his death. He saw the salvation of multitudes. In Isaiah chapter 53 verse 10, yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He has put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, and he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see the travail of his soul, and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous servant justify many. My righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. That's what Jesus saw. And when you have that comprehensive vision, then you'll be able to just endure the pain. You understand? There's pain before the gain, and there's no gain without pain. But you do not concentrate on the pain, you concentrate on the gain. You see it afar as a leader who sees. Then we're looking at Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11, I'm reading from verse 24. Hebrews 11, reading from verse 24. By faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the sons of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt. For he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. By faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. He endured as seeing him who is invisible. And so when you see, then you are going to be able to endure. And if you are not able to endure, you're looking in the wrong direction. You're seeing the wrong thing. You're looking at the pain, you're not looking at the gain, and you're not looking at the future. When you are training people and you see some kind of peculiarities in those people you are training, you see some of the eccentricities, those people you are training, or you see some of the kind of incompetencies about those people that you are training, and you see that some of those people you are training, you know, a child or maybe a trainee, somebody you are training, is not going to be behaving perfectly every time, acting normal every time. And there are some things that, you know, sometimes some young people, some things come into their head and temporarily they misbehave. And sometimes, you know, a person can misbehave out of joy. A person can misbehave out of, you know, familiarity. A person can misbehave out of forgetfulness. He just forgets himself, and he forgets that you are still his leader. And then he does something, and it's childish, and it's immature, and it's sometimes it even appears rude, and sometimes it appears impolite, and sometimes it appears, you know, I think I need to, you know, watch myself. If I'm not very careful, I'm going to lose my self-respect with this person. The way he's acting is temporary. Look beyond that. Look beyond that and see that the Lord wants you to be a leader who is a seer. And you go beyond the temporal and you go to the eternal. Why we look at things, not the things that are seen, but the things which are not seen. But the things which are seen are temporal, and the things which are not seen are eternal. And if you were to look at Moses, for example, when he was arguing with the Lord, oh Lord, send anybody you want to send, I cannot go, it's not me. If that is all you see, you will not concentrate on Moses and develop him and let him actually grow. And if you look at Joshua, for example, my Lord, Moses, those two people that are prophesying in the camp, stop them. And you say that this kind of fellow that wants to stop everybody just because they are not lining up, if this one becomes the final leader, how is he going to be relating to the people? Just be stopping this and stopping that one if they are not acting correct. But don't look at that. That's a temporary thing. And if you look at the sons of thunder, let's call them fire upon them so that they will not allow you to pass through Samaria. What kind of insult and injuries this upon our master? Let's destroy him. After all, we now have the power, as Elijah did call fire upon the people. If you thought about that, you will not develop the apostle of love. You are not going to develop John because of the temporary things that you see. The point the Lord is telling us is that a leader is a seer. Don't look at the temporal.
Don't look at the at what is happening today. See beyond what is happening to this brother, what is happening to this sister, and commit yourself to training them, bringing them to the place where they ought to be. We're looking at Acts of the Apostles chapter 26. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 26, I'm reading from verse 13. Acts of the Apostles chapter 26, reading from verse 13. And at midday, O king, I saw in the way a light from heaven above the brightness of the sun shining round about me and them which journeyed with me. And when we were all falling to the earth, I heard a voice speaking unto me and saying in the Hebrew tongue, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. Hey, let's stop here for a moment. Let's speak this Saul. What did he do? He made havoc of the church. Can we think of other people that made havoc of the people of God? You can think about Pharaoh. You can think about Nebuchadnezzar. You can think about Herod. Now you think about Saul. Did God act to Saul the way he acted to Pharaoh? He dunked Pharaoh and his chariots in the sea. Did God act to Saul the way he acted to Nebuchadnezzar? Nebuchadnezzar became an animal. Did he act to Saul the way he acted to Herod? Those that are seeking your life and the life of the child, they are dead. Go back to the land. He killed him. And then the Herod in chapter 12 of Acts, what happened? An angel smote him and he died, and worms were coming out. He died immediately. But look at Saul. What did those other people do greater than what Saul did, making havoc of the church? But you see, because God saw something in Saul, and because the Lord Jesus Christ saw something, you don't act to everybody the same way. And you know the way we act. This brother has done this. I've acted this way. This other brother has done something similar. And if it's not the same thing, if you look at the value of what the person has done, it's almost like the value of what the other fellow has done. And the other fellow has done something very, very similar to you. Now I want to be a consistent leader. I don't want people to accuse me of partiality. He did that, this is what I did. He did something similar, that's what I did. And he has done this now, and similar to what this other fellow has done. For the people to see that I'm consistent, I'm going to do exactly the same thing. Be a seer. Be a seer. See beyond the action. And see the future. And see what God wants to produce out of Pharaoh, out of Nebuchadnezzar, out of Herod, out of Saul. That's why you don't act the same way to everybody. In fact, that's the reason you are going to pray and think and meditate before you ever take an action. Now we come to the case of Saul. After he had done everything that he did, then the Lord appeared to him and he saw this great light. And then it says in verse 14, Saul, so why persecutest thou me? And I said, who art thou, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus whom thou persecutest. But rise and stand upon thy feet. Rise and stand upon thy feet, for I have appeared unto thee for this purpose, to make thee a minister and a witness both of these things which thou hast seen, and of those things in the which I will appear unto thee. Do we act to all the people that were persecuting the church before? Every one of them, now they line up. And here comes somebody persecuting the church before. I'm born again now. I've repented now. And I want to tell you that the Lord wants me to work for him. Okay, join the working team. The next person says the same thing, join the working team. The next person, join the working team. No, not at all. You don't act to the same people, to different people, the same way. You know, sometimes, because we read that passage of scripture, and it says, not a novice. Lest being lifted up by pride, he fall into the condemnation of the devil. And so there is a standing principle, there's a standing law. If anybody gets converted, he must wait for either 3 years or 7 years before he can be this and that. And we apply that to everybody. And here comes somebody like Saul. And as Saul, he had read the whole of the Old Testament. Only he didn't know the interpretation. As Saul, the persecutor of the church, he was versed as a Pharisee. and the son of a Pharisee. He was versed in the Old Testament, and he could recite some of the Psalms from memory, even Psalm 119, because that's what those Pharisees did. And this man that knew the whole Bible, only to be able to connect the Bible with the Lord Jesus Christ and know that all those symbols there and all those rituals there and all those ceremonies there, everything was pointing to the Lord Jesus Christ. That was the only connection remaining. And now he came, and as he came, he was converted. And the Lord said, I've appeared unto you for this purpose. Now you are going to be a witness of the things that you have seen, and you are going to be a minister. And if a soul like that got converted in our church today, you know what we're going to do? He just got converted last week, and then the best we can do for him, we'll tell him go and join the converts class. And he's there, and as the, you know, the teacher teaching them is talking about this and talking about this, he's raising up his hand and he's saying, actually this one, and he begins to see some deep things. Okay, we understand, we just keep quiet and learn, be humble, be teachable, and learn what you need to learn. And then he goes through that with everybody else, and then we give him this, our form to fill. I mean, you know, what's the name of your wife? I'm not married yet. How many children do you have? I said, I'm not married. How can I have any child? What's your name? I am Saul. Where are you coming from? I'm of Tarsus. How many languages do you speak? I speak Greek, I speak Hebrew, I speak Aramaic. And what have you done before? If you want to hear my testimony, actually, I was do you remember that brother who died you know, in the state, you know, some time ago? Yes, we remember. Actually, I was one of the people that planned the death of that individual. And when that fellow was crying and saying, charge this not to the account, I just shake my head and say, look at this, a foolish fellow, we're going to kill the rest of you. Are you? Yes, I am. How did you come to join the Converts class? I'm born again now. Okay, we'll look at your case specially. And then we pass all the other people, and we're going to disqualify him. Be a seer, be a seer. Don't deal with everybody the same way. Look at them one by one and see where they are coming from and see what the Lord appoints them to do. That's why the Lord is telling us that as leaders, we must be seers. And if any of us become a seers, don't judge those of us who have the eyes of Christ and we have the mind of Christ and the vision of the Spirit of God, that, you know, you're accusing us. How is it they put somebody there to be doing something? How did they put that person there to be doing something? Do you know that Paul the Apostle did much more than even Peter and the rest of them? And the reason is because the Lord Jesus had the eyes to see. It tells us in verse 16, but rise and stand upon thy feet, for I have appeared unto thee for this purpose, to make thee a minister and a witness both of the things which thou hast seen and of the things in the which I will appear unto thee, delivering thee from the people and from the Gentiles, unto whom I now send thee to open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. Whereupon, O King Agrippa, I was not disobedient unto the heavenly vision. Well, we don't have enough time to comment on that. Verse 19, I was not disobedient unto the heavenly vision. Can you trace the spiritual ministerial journey of Peter? Can you see the graph going up and coming down? Can you see the time of coming out of the work? Can you see the time of denying Christ? Can you see the time of being a little bit fearful? And can you see the time of abandoning the work? I go a fishing, then come back and trace the ministerial graph of Paul the Apostle. I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision. Once he got started, he kept moving on. Yes, he suffered, but he kept moving on. Is it possible that in this ministry we have lost some people and we have hidden them somewhere, and they have not been doing the work? Hey, let me give you an example. Sometimes, you know, somebody who has been a Muslim, he gets converted. And you may be, you know, you're Samuel, and you're James, and you're John, and my brother here is John, that's Christopher there, and we have Matthew there, and you can tell all of those names. Those are Christian names. Even before you were born again, you were a nominal Christian, and you believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, being the Son of God. All that you needed to have is somebody to connect it with salvation and be born again. But here is somebody now, he was a Muslim. And he was almost like a die-hard Muslim. And you have never been in Islam. You know a little bit of Islam. And this fellow, when he was in Islam, he'll go to the mosque, he'll go here, he'll go there. If they wanted to cause trouble in any church, he'll spearhead all the trouble and scatter all those nominal Christians, you know, in their churches. And if they say there's anything, he will carry whatever it is, and then he'll be chanting the song. And Golib, he was not afraid of anything. When they start throwing arrows and stones, and some people are, you know, afraid, and the dojin, he will come right to the front, and then he'll stretch his chest like this and say, shoot me if you can. And those nominal Christians, they become afraid and they run away, and he pursues them, and then he drives them. Some people break their leg and they break their hands. And then eventually, now this fanatical Muslim, he saw the vision of the Lord in our state, and then he became born again. And then after he became born again, he then began to read the Bible. And he read the Bible through in 1 month. He had read everything, because that's how he read the Quran. The way he did the Quran, he is not doing the Bible. He will read and recite and read and recite. And right now, then he has a vision. I'm going to do double in the kingdom of God now than what I did, for the devil when I was persecuting the Christians. And the fellow does not know how to take permission. And the fellow does not know to say, sir, the Lord is leading me that I will go to the Muslims that, you know, I came out from them. I'm going to the mosque and I'm going to tell them, I'm going to show them that Jesus is Christ and Jesus is the Lord. I know all the things they're saying there. You say, calm down. First of all, have you attended this and this? No. Okay. The best I can do for you, join the workers team. We have, do you know when we have workers or something? We have it on Friday. We have it. Sir, that one I cannot attend. It is on that Friday I will go to the mosque while they are there. While they are coming out like this, that's the time I'm going to confront them. Please, if you want to be a worker, be humble, be gentle, be teachable, be obedient. Disobedient people cannot do anything in the kingdom of God. Sir, this one, I know the fire burning in me. Those people, I'm going to rescue them. Okay. Then he goes. And then you tell him, this is dangerous. Dangerous. You are talking like Matthew. You are not talking like Ibrahim. When you say this is dangerous, you are talking like Stephen. You are not talking like Saibu. When you say this is dangerous, you are talking like a nominal Christian. You are not talking like a fanatical Muslim who became converted, who doesn't fear death, who knows that when you die, don't you understand, in the religion that is coming from, when you die in holy war like that, there's a special place reserved for you in heaven. In fact, I'm going to tell you this, that the Muslims don't have any hope of heaven, any hope of paradise, except you die in fighting against those heathen people, against those Christians. It's only when you die for the cause, you are sure you are going to get to heaven. And he had got that in his mind since he was born, since he was sitting on the ground and learning the thing. And now he knows that even if I die, that will be wonderful. He doesn't know about Stephen, about all the other people. All he knows that even when you die for this great cause, then that is wonderful. And then he's going there. And then you keep on working on him, telling him, slow down, cool down, don't endanger your life. Life is very precious. And then until, if he listens to you, until you destroy him. And now he comes back. And now today, as you are hearing about Muslim evangelization, you go back to your state. And then you make announcement, we're going to evangelize the state. And you think that he'll be the first one to raise up his hand and volunteer. And he's sitting back. And he, you know, the fire is gone, the zeal is gone, the courage is gone. He doesn't want to endanger his life anymore now. You have brainwashed him that death is a serious matter and somebody should not die. And therefore, he has lost all the fire that he got before. We have done a lot of damage to some people, and we have not encouraged them. When we felt that this is dangerous for you, let them do it. The Lord will protect them. See Paul the apostle here, and thank God he wasn't in Jerusalem. If he was in Jerusalem, you know what they would have done to him? Because later in chapter 21, when he came to Jerusalem, you know, James called him with the elders in Jerusalem. They said, Saul, Paul, sit down here. We hear of all that you have been doing in the Gentile world. That's okay. But over here in Jerusalem, you know, we are reasonable people here. You know, Christianity makes us matured. We're matured people here. And we know how we'll deal with the Jewish people there. Therefore, as you come over here now, you go to the temple and do what other people are doing and show them that you too, you are a reasonable believer and you are not contrary to the laws of the fathers. Do you hear? We got into this thing before you came in. Therefore, listen. Whatever Holy Ghost baptism you have and whatever strategy you have, whatever zeal you have, you didn't see Jesus face to face. We stayed with him 3.5 years before he went to the cross and before he died. Listen to instruction. Yes, sir, I listen. And then for the first time in his life, he went to, you know, the temple. And the thing he has been preaching against, you know, began to do all. And then the people said, hey, come over here. This is the man that everywhere troubled everybody. And James was not there now to deliver him. Because those people, they have been so mature, they never get into trouble. You know, they just do their ministry properly. They go in and they go out. Nobody ever troubles them. And the trouble still came upon Paul the apostle. But thank God, Paul the apostle was ready for it. I said they are ready for it. And there are some of these younger people who are ready for just anything that we are not ready for. That's the reason you ought to be a seer. Even if you cannot do it, see it in them that they can do it and they will do it in Jesus' name. And vision is that ability that makes you to see in a way that compels you to action and attention. And visions are silent shapers of our destiny and silent shapers of our thoughts and of our lives and of our ministries as well. Vision is like a magnifying glass which creates focus, and leaders are seers who live by the unseen. I come to point number two, the comprehensive vocation of a seer leader. The comprehensive vocation of a seer leader. And we're looking at Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. We're looking at verse 1. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1. I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called. We know that Paul the apostle was speaking to all the believers. But now as we apply this to the believers who are serving the Lord in some capacities, the vocation wherewith ye are called. Vocation. Your calling. And the area of work you ought to be involved in, that you will walk worthy of that vocation. You'll concentrate on that vocation. You will have concern for the growth and the usefulness of that vocation, and that you will just addict yourself to the ministry the Lord has called you to that vocation. And let's see the vocations that people had. We're looking at Exodus chapter 3. In Exodus chapter 3, we're looking at it from verse 1. Exodus chapter 3, reading from verse 1. Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. And let's stop there for a moment. Sometimes, you know, when you're on a journey, you miss quite a lot of things on the way in your journey. And we don't want to miss this in the journey of Moses. Moses at this time, if you go to Acts of the Apostles chapter 7, you'll see that his life is divided into three parts, 40, 40, and 40. And the first 40 he had spent in Egypt. That's when he became learned in all the knowledge and the wisdom of Egypt. And then the next 40 years, you'll find him in the wilderness there with the flock of his father Jethro. And when you add 40 and 40, that is what? 80. Now, when you think of 80, put your finger there in Exodus chapter 3 and come to Psalm 90. Psalm 90. As we look at Psalm 90, first of all, you are going to look at the title on top of Psalm 90. If it's in your Bible, have you opened Psalm 90? Psalm 90, please, everybody. I know you are writing. I like you to write. I also like you to look at the passage. There's something important we're passing across here. Psalm 90, are we there now? What's the title? Can we read the title out loud? a prayer of Moses, the man of God. Now we're going to look at verse 10. The days of our years are 70 and 10. 70 means 60 and 10. And then it says, and if by reason of strength they be 80 years, 80 years, yet is their strength labor and sorrow, for it is soon cut off and will fly away. Stop there. Moses said the days of our years, just 70 years, and if by strength we're able to go beyond other people, maybe 80 years, and then it's full of labor and sorrow because it will soon be cut off. I'm coming back to Exodus chapter 3 now. Exodus chapter 3 verse 1. Moses became 80 years of age, and with what he himself wrote in Psalm 90, what should he be thinking of now? My life is soon to be cut off. Anything you have not done at the age of 80, he must have thought, cannot be done again. And he tells us that a fool at 40 is a fool forever. And if you have not discovered yourself, if you have not discovered your ministry, if you have not discovered your usefulness by the age of 80, you are gone. And he was 80 already, and the Lord appeared unto him. Can I just remind you once again, see with the eyes of the Lord. See yourself with the eyes of the Lord. If we think of 70, let me approximate it to 72 for easy division. Divide 72 by 3. You have 24, 24, and 24. Take the first two, you are 48. And there may be people that will think, once you are 48, two-thirds of your life gone. If you have not achieved anything by 48, what do you still want to achieve? And who wants to keep you? And if you want to keep people in your employment, in your job, once they're reaching 45, or they're reaching 48, or they're reaching 50, are you going to employ them anymore? Here comes somebody to you now, and he says, Pastor, the Lord is calling me, and the Lord wants me to do this. I want to come on full time. And then you say, okay, we'll give you a form. You need to go come for an interview. Well, we have a panel in our church, and that panel will interview you and see the details, whether you can make it or not. By the way, how old are you? Well, I am 60 years of age now. 60 years of age. And you want to come on full time. And what do you want to do as full time? Well, I want to be a preacher. In fact, if possible, I want to. There's a nation the Lord has been laying on my heart. He didn't lay that nation on your heart when you were 37, when you were 38. Now you are 60. He's laying that on your heart. All right, I will look for the form. And what's your name, your address, which district are you care? When I get the form, I'll send to you. You don't want to tell him up front, you're 60 years of age. If I send you to the panel, once they hear about your age, they're not even going to interview you. You're disqualified. Shouldn't we be very careful and deal with each individual on the merit of the calling of God upon their lives? And not just have this overall thing, general. Is 60, is disqualified. Is 70, is disqualified. And here we have 80. And the Lord called him, and is just to get started what he ought to do. All I'm saying here is that let the leader be a seer. And you see people individually, and you see them in a peculiar way, and each one is dealt with according to the calling of God upon his life. The rules are there, but don't forget the exceptions. In verse 2, and the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burnt with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, while the bush is not burnt. And when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here I am. And he said, draw not near hither. Put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the God of thy father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people, which are in Egypt, and have heard their cry, by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows, and I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land unto a good land and a large, unto a land flowing with milk and honey, unto the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel is come unto me, and I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptians oppressed them. Come now therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. Now it was time for God to send in. And Moses appeared not to be ready at this time. There was a time that Moses was ready. God was not ready at that time. That's the time he used his wrong method and killed an Egyptian. But he did it the wrong way. The Lord is telling us that we should look at the people. And then as we see them, see the vocation that they are called to. And as they are called to that vocation, we allow them to minister in that way that the Lord is allowing them to minister in. We're coming to Isaiah chapter 6. Isaiah chapter 6. And in Isaiah chapter 6, we're looking at from verse 1, you know the story already by yourself. Isaiah chapter 6. In Isaiah chapter 6, looking at verse 1. And let us see the calling of Isaiah here. And let us see the way the Lord brought Isaiah to actually have or to actually do what he ought to do in the kingdom of God. In particular, let's look at verse 1. It says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple, and above it stood the seraphims, each one had six wings. With twain he covered his face, with twain he covered his feet, and with twain he did fly. There's a lot there, no time for them, for those things now. And one cried unto another and said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The Lord, the whole earth is full of his glory. And the posts of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke. Then said I, woe is me, for I am undone, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. I know we know this story. I want to think about myself. Suppose I were in the congregation, because sometimes I come to the congregation. Suppose another person was preaching, and then I came to the congregation, and you know, the brother finished the preaching. After the preaching, then he said, let's rise up and pray. And I didn't come back to the front. I stayed there. And then I stay near somebody there who has been appointed as one of our state overseers, one of our national overseers, or some one of our region overseers, or maybe a language region overseer. And the message that was given greet him. And as it greet him, he began to pray. And he was praying aloud, and I could hear. And then he began to say, oh Lord, woe is me. I am undone. I'm a man of unclean lips. What's going to be occurring to my heart, to my mind at that time? And I look at him and I say, okay, look at the people. These people are choosing to be leaders. And see the way he's praying. I am undone, a man of unclean lips. And he continues to pray like that. And he's really crying, and you know, with fervency. And it's like, well, his heart is almost going to break. Oh Lord, help me. I'm a man of unclean lips. I'm a man of unclean lips. I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. Then something is occurring to my mind. This fellow should not have been here. Because to see this fellow is, look at the prayer. See the message that we got now. And see the way he's praying. He must have been gossiping. He must have been backbiting. This one is a backslider here. Be very careful how you judge the utterances of people, whether it is when they are praying or when they are giving suggestion, or when we raise up our hands and we're discussing, and somebody comes and he talks something that is in the depth of his heart. And then we're looking at them, we're saying, they didn't choose the good region of Asias in that place. Because if they chose them, look at this one that came now. But you see, God was not seen like that. The point we're looking at is as a leader. Let us see with the eyes of the Lord. What did the Lord do? In fact, let's finish. What should you have done? If you were in that situation or had a person praying like that, after the prayer, you don't want to leave that place so that after the prayer you will be able to hold him so he will not escape. You say, please see me at the back here. What's your name? Which region are you coming from? And then after he has, you know, mentioned the something, the region, say, okay, say at the back, who's your region, who's your state over here? It's a brother, so please come. Then you meet at the back there. How did you bring this person to our planning meeting? What kind of person is this? And then you say, please go to the hostel and then pack your load and go. You say, but what you are saying, you must have done that, before. Look at my face here. I have done like that before. And you have done like that before. Because you see, as leaders, we must grow. And as we grow, we now begin to see with the eyes of the Lord. Be patient with them. Ask them, why were you praying like that? What was occurring to your mind? What have you done? Don't just judge because of what the fellow is saying or because of the way the fellow is praying now and say he's disqualified. I've done that before. When I go around and I hear how people pray and I see some of the things they talk, and without checking up, I look at the superficial thing, the superficial statement they are making, or the superficial action that they are putting forth. And because of my superficial view of the superficial thing they are doing, then I take a superficial decision and they are gone. And how many of them should not have gone? They should have stayed here. And that's the reason why, as you read the Bible, you will, I hope you're likely to see something. When I read the Bible, I look for things I didn't see before. You know, if I read this Bible to you, this passage to you, all that I'm saying, now you might not see that. And that's another thing, as a leader, you will see what you have not seen before. So that it's not just immediately you read Isaiah chapter 6 verses 1 to 7. This is what you saw before. This is what you said before. That is what you always say. That's what you always see. There must be a change and there must be a difference. Let us begin to now look with the eyes of the leader, and then we'll see what we didn't see before. And you know, sometimes if you listen to me when I preach, sometimes I say things that instead of you looking at yourself and you looking at your leadership, something will be running in your mind. Look at the way the pastor is preaching. And I hope that he sees that what he's preaching is also correcting him, because he did that before. The reason I'm telling you this now is that some preachers will not preach that to their congregation. If what they are going to say, their congregation will apply it back to the preacher and say, but our state overseer, you are preaching like that, but how about you? Give them the truth. Whether it goes against what you said before, it didn't go against what you said before, so the people will know that you are growing. They will know that you are sincere with the word of God, and what you see in the word of God, you tell the people, they know that you are not hiding anything away. And that's the focus of the leadership. You're not trying to protect yourself, you're not trying to exalt yourself, and you're not trying to, you know, make the people say, I'm a good man, I'm a great man, I never made any mistake in my life. Of course we made mistakes. Didn't I tell you when I made mistake yesterday, when I opened Ezekiel chapter 34 and verse 16, and I was looking for Isaiah chapter 34 verse 16, then I told you directly, that's a mistake. But quickly I told you that God got a miracle out of that mistake. And you know, every mistake you make, if you yield yourself to the Lord and you are sincere, God can bring a miracle out of your mistake. Give me a good amen. Amen. Happy amen. Amen. God bless every one of you. Vision grabs a leader and shows him the destination, and it points him to the right direction and propels him to decision and fires him with determination, encouraging him that he should get moving. And the road may be rough and the road may be steep and the road may be high, yet that vision will shape your destiny. And look at it here in verse 6. Then flew one of the seraphims unto him, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with the tongues from off the altar. Now, what should you do if one of your leaders came to you, and your leaders, they confess to you and they say, pastor, overseer, this is in my life, this is in my life. You look at that thing. Is this thing strong enough to disqualify and to send away and to drive away somebody you have been training for 15 years? Somebody you have been training for 20 years. Now he came to tell you, pastor, this happened to me. Evaluate that thing. And as you evaluate that thing, are you to cleanse him? Are you to counsel him? Are you to wash him? Are you to pray with him? After praying with him, then release him. Go back to your work. In fact, give him a greater responsibility. Or is it every little thing that somebody says, pastor, overseer, look at what has happened to me. Look at this and look at this. Immediately, as if we were waiting, we're looking for something before. Somebody you have trained for 15 years, you have forgotten your labor on them. And you have forgotten what you have been doing on them. You say, okay, that's what you have done. Get out of the work. And then you put somebody that is not competent, not capable, not ready to do the work. And that other fellow is still there. Are there things we can just tell people, okay, you need cleansing? I'm not talking about, you know, terrible things that we all know that we're talking about. But I'm talking about, you know, some people do some things, and those things are not perfect, and those things are not right. And all they need is cleansing. And all they need is our compassion. It's our counseling. And then we counsel them and release them into their service, into their ministries. So that after you have labored for years, 15 years, 20 years, something little thing will not happen that, you know, you just send them away. And then you have lost all your labor that you have labored on them for all these years. Look at this, Isaiah. He's been preaching from chapter 1 to chapter 5. And now he saw the vision of the Lord. And then he made the confession. And then the cleansing came. And then, lo, this has touched thy lips, thy iniquity is taken away, thy sin is purged. And also I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send, and who shall go for us? And he said, here am I, send me. I pray God will help us. Vision leads to a vocation and determines our values and compels us to vigilance and produces vigor, vitality in us, and encourages virtue and creates ventures and leads on to victory. When God gives you a vision, that will lead to a vocation. Because after he saw the vision here, the Lord said, I have a work to do. Whom shall I send? Vocation. And it determines our values. When you see a vision, your worldview changes. And the things you value, they actually change. You now begin to put value on the things that are actually valuable. It compels vigilance. Now the Lord has given you the vision. As the Lord has given you that vision, you now become more vigilant. And then it produces vigor and vitality. You know, like Moses, you are now 80 years of age. And at 80 years of age, you are getting tired already. You are getting ready to go home. And saying, I'm coming home, Lord. Heaven is my home. And the kind of songs you are singing, those songs have changed. When you were at your earlier life, the songs you sang, songs of consecration. Now you've done a lot, and you are 80 years of age, and you're not singing songs of coming home. But it's at that time, the Lord gives you a vision, and that now produces vigor in you. I'm not ready to go yet. There's still a lot I'm going to do for the Lord. And it encourages virtue. If the Lord is showing me a vision like this, I should be virtuous and create ventures. You'll be able to take risks. Eventually, will lead you to victory. And so you keep going. You have a vision. Focus on that vision. You have a mission to hold onto. You have a goal to pursue. You have a plan to execute. You have a project to start. You have a problem to tackle. You have a challenge to overcome. And you have a decision to make. You have a dream to realize. And you are going to realize your dream in Jesus' name. I hear somebody saying, you're too fast. And I want to write those things. Am I right? Okay, let me go slow. I said you keep going. You have a vision to focus on. A vision to focus on. Then you have a mission to hold on to. Hold on to that mission. A mission to hold on to. You have a goal to pursue. Don't be distracted. Pursue that goal. And you have a plan to execute. Execute those plans. A project to start. Get started. Get started. You may not have got all the resources, but get started. A problem to tackle. Tackle those problems. Don't allow the problems to send you back from the mission field. A problem to tackle. A challenge to overcome. A decision to make. And a dream to realize. So keep going. I come to point number 3. The character building virtue of a seer leader. The character building virtue of a seer leader. I've said much already on these areas, and I'm just going to summarize, but please write these references down. Exodus chapter 4, verses 10 to 14. Exodus chapter 4, verses 10 to 14. Together with Deuteronomy chapter 34, verses 10 to 12. Then Esther chapter 2, verses 7 and 20. Together with Esther chapter 4, verses 1 to 17. Now these other series of references, I just read to bring out a particular thing. We're looking at Mark chapter 3, verse 17. And James, the son of Zebedee, and John, the brother of James, and he surnamed them Boanerges, which is the sons of thunder. James and John. James and John, sons of thunder. In Mark chapter 10, Mark chapter 10, verse 35. Mark chapter 10, verse 35. It tells us, and James and John, the sons of Zebedee, come unto him, saying, Master, we would that thou shouldest do for us whatsoever we desire of thee. Verse 37, they said unto him, grant unto us that we may sit one on thy right hand and the other on thy left hand in thy glory. James and John. Chapter 9 of Luke. Luke chapter 9, verse 51. And it came to pass, when the time was come that he should be received up, he steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem. And he sent messengers before his face. And they went and entered into a village of the Samaritans to make ready for him. And he did not receive him, because his face was as though he would go to Jerusalem. And when his disciples James and John saw this, they said, Lord, wilt thou that we command fire to come down from heaven and consume them, even as Elias did? Can you see that James and John, James and John, James and John, those three times, and those three times spanned a very long period. But now, do you know what Jesus did before he left? The Lord, he didn't reject them. He didn't throw them away. Yes, he corrected them. He even rebuked them. Well, so he even chastised them. But he didn't disqualify them. But it's interesting to see what Jesus Christ did before he left. I want you to look at Luke chapter 22. And this is how we help people. When you see that their association have been affecting their character, has been affecting their worldview, has been affecting their attitude and the things that they do, then you follow after the Lord Jesus Christ, because you can see something in them. The leader is a seer, and you want to build a good character in them. Let's see what Jesus did in Luke chapter 22. Luke chapter 22, I'm reading from verse 7. Then came the day of the unleavened bread, when the Passover must be killed. And he sent who and who? And he sent Peter and John. And you know what he did? He removed John from the association with James. James was a good person, and John was a good person, but there was a kind of characteristics. And when nothing comes on James, the senior brother, eventually the junior brother will just, you know, accept and will just go along. Yes, let's call down fire. Yes, let's do this. Let's do this. But these are two good people. Separate them and associate them with the kind of character you want to build in them. And so he now associated him with Peter before he died. Would you realize that that association helped John? Acts of the Apostles chapter 3. In Acts chapter 3, verse 1. Now Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour. No more James and John. The Lord, just by giving them responsibility, you don't have to talk too much. It's by action. As a leader, you can see what you want to build up, the character building virtue of a seer leader. Now it was John and Peter. And then in Acts of the Apostles chapter 4 verse 19. But Peter and John answered and said, whether it be right in the sight of God to hearken unto you more than unto God, judge ye. Chapter 8 verse 14. In chapter 8 verse 14, now when the apostles which were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent unto them Peter and John. Let's see the effect now on John. We're looking at first John. In 1 John chapter 4, we're looking at verse 17. 1 John chapter 4, verse 17. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, even so are we in this world. The thing I'm pointing out to you is, when two people are together, they have good influence on one another, or they may also have bad influence on one another. If one person is aggressive, the other person too, well, that character, that attitude will rub on the other fellow, and he'll also be aggressive. And the Lord Jesus Christ saw, I need James, I need John. And as long as they are together, the bad attitude and the bad quality that I want to remove from them, so they can be more useful, will be reinforced. Because as James is doing it, John too will be doing it, and nothing is reinforced. So you separate them, and then you link them up with another individual, and then there's a new worldview now, a new attitude now. And there is John, you will see that John was a quiet person. And until Peter will say, ask Jesus about this, even though he's lying on the bosom of Jesus, he will not say anything. He was a good follower. And then when he linked in with Peter, all that James would have suggested, those things were not there anymore. And when you remove those things away from them, by the absence of the things that were coming before, those things are being taken away little by little, then eventually he's forgotten. He cannot develop his own real personality and be the apostle of love. Of course, James too was still there and was still doing what he needed to do. The point I'm making is, when God chooses us as leaders, and we see with the eyes of a leader, and you see how people are, you see what is affecting them, you see what is influencing them, then you think, then you pray, then you plan, what can I do for this brother so that he will develop himself to his full potential, and do to the other brother and still develop himself to the full potential. Then you become people developers, and that's what God has made us. That's what we're going to be, in Jesus' name. Let's rise up and talk to the Lord in prayer. We're leaders and we're seers. Leaders, we're seers.
Pastor Dada, he has been a father to me. I don't start crying. Okay, I remember I came here without scholarship to Howard University. The first year wasn't easy, but I got a grant that paid half of my tuition. But then from second year, I got like 5 different scholarships from my department. So I just thank God. Third year, the same thing. And I thank God because I'll be graduating in May. I didn't have to take out the loan. I just thank God for all his provision. I just bless the name of God.